You may think you can condemn such people, but you are just as bad and you have no excuse. When you say they are wicked and should be punished, you are condemning yourself, for you who judge others do these very same things, and we know that God in his justice will punish anyone who do such things. Since you judge others for doing these things, why do you think you can avoid God's judgment when you do the same things? Don't you see how wonderful, kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that his kindness is intent to turn you from your sin?
But because you are stubborn and refuse to turn from your sin, you are storing up terrible punishment for yourself. For a day of anger is coming when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will judge everyone according to what they have done. He will give eternal life to those who keep on doing good, seeking after the glory and honor and immortality that God offers. But he will pour out his anger, wreaked on those who live for themselves, who refuse to obey the truth, and instead lives lives of wickedness. There will be trouble and calamity for everyone who keeps on doing what is evil, for the Jewish voice and also for the Gentiles. But there will be glory and honor, peace from God for all who do good, for the Jew first, also for the Gentiles. For God does not show favoritism. When the Gentiles sin, they will be destroyed, even though they never had God's written law. And the Jews who do have God's law will be judged by the law when they fail to obey it. For merely listening to the law does not make us right with God. It is obeying the law that makes us right in his sight. Even Gentiles who do not have God's written law show that they know his law when they instantly obey it. Even without having heard their hearts for their own conscience and thought, either accuse them or tell them they are doing right. This is the mercy I proclaim, that the day is coming when God, through Christ Jesus, will judge everyone's secret life. This is the word of the Almighty God.
This stage area up here, you may notice, has this plastic stuff down on the ground, and they asked us not to step on that or put things on it, and even not to bring all the seats out. The reason this is all set up like this is because in December the school is going to do a production of The Wizard of Oz. Some of you know the story. I don't know how worldwide this story is known, but it's about a girl named Dorothy whose home was sucked up into the air by a tornado. And when it landed, she went to open the door, not knowing what was outside the door. And this movie was one of the first movies that was filmed in color. So the first part of the movie is all in black and white, the tornado and the house and landing. And when she goes to open the door, as it swings open through the door, suddenly it's in Technicolor. To say she's stepping into a new world. This is a door into a whole new world. And what she sees is something like this. This fantastic world full of color and the yellow brick road, right? That's not quite what it looked like in the original movie. That's from some more recent one. But it looks a little more colorful, a little better graphics for us. Now, is this world that we see all there is, or is there something more? Is this physical world that we live in all that there is? Or are there other realms, other parts of reality? And if there is more, how do we get there? What is the door to any other world that there may be? Is there any other way to live than the kinds of things that we see around us now? Or is there another alternative? So far, we've been looking through this book of Romans, and just now we get to chapter 2. Somebody asked yesterday, boy, this is going to take a long time to get through the book of Romans, isn't it? Well, if we keep going at this pace, yes, it will take quite a while. We'll take a break at least in December. But what we've been learning so far is that the Apostle Paul is writing this message, this letter to the church in Rome, a place where there were a lot of skeptics, there were a lot of alternative things that people could believe. And he's explaining about God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and how they were at work in history, that Jesus came at a certain time in this world as a human being. So then we said there should be, since this happened in history, there should be historical evidence. There should be some things left behind, as there are. And we, Jan spoke about being unashamed of the gospel, that this is God's power for salvation, therefore we're not ashamed about it. We spent a week looking about some of the reasons to believe that there is a God, which is important. A lot of you, when you go to work or school, you may be the only person who believes that there is a God, and we need to be reminded there are good reasons to believe this. Last week, we looked at some of the good things about the fact that God gets angry, and that it, in the end, leads us to experience God's grace and goodness. But there is a right and wrong in the world, and that is good, because we need to be able to say, that is evil, and it should not happen. Now today, this long passage that Momo and his daughter Ruth read for us is saying we can agree that things that happen in the world are wrong, that they are evil. But, he says, when we make that judgment, we cannot do it from a place of saying, I'm better. They are evil, and I am good. God will judge them, but not me. He says, quite clearly, when we make a judgment over something in the world, we are judging ourselves because we do the same things. You'll say, yeah, but I'm not as bad. I don't do things to the same extent as other people. That may be true, but that's not the point. All of us have gone beyond what our own standards tell us. There's been in the news recently a lot of people condemning this movie producer from Hollywood named Harvey Weinstein. I don't know if you've all heard about it, but over 30 women say he pressured them or forced them to sleep with him. And he's the one who had the power. He could give them a role in the movie. He could make their career take off or not. He's the one who had money. It could cover things up if there were ever any accusations. And so things stayed silent for all that time. And over, people, public figures, everybody is coming out to say, that man is wrong. That what he did is wrong. And they're right. Nobody should use power to pressure or force other people to do the things that he did. But when we read what we read in this Romans chapter 2, when we say that that is wrong, we need to recognize that we are also saying there are things about ourselves that are also wrong. We say it is wrong to treat women like that, then we need to recognize we have not treated women fairly or as equals. we say it is wrong to abuse power, then recognize the ways we have misused power ourselves. And the result then is that we all end up in the same situation of recognizing we need forgiveness. We need to be made new. And so, this passage in Romans gives two ways of life leading to two different destinations, which we'll see. This is our words that are just pulled from the passage. It talks about wickedness, sin, and evil. People who live for themselves, who refuse to obey the truth, who live lives of wickedness. And it talks about punishment, anger, wrath, and judgment. This might make you uncomfortable. In fact, I don't really particularly like to talk about anger and wrath and punishment, but they are there in the scriptures. And this is a part of who God is. And as we said last week, this is good. That God says evil is evil. Because we live in a world where there are things that happen that are horrendous, and we need to be able to say this is wrong. Now the other part, the good part here, is it also talks about glory and honor and immortality. And again, it uses the words glory and honor and peace. And this great word, eternal life. Two ways of living leading to two final destinations. And if you look at these two, we would probably all say, I would like to have glory and honor and peace. I would like to have eternal life. And there is a door between these two worlds. Some of you might remember the movie The Matrix, and here's a picture of it. Maybe one of the most famous scenes in this movie. It's about a man who finds that he's living not in the real world, but he's living in some kind of simulation, like a great video game that some other alien species is running. As I know, it's a little strange, right? And he's pulled out of this fake world into the real world, but he's given this choice. Say, you take the blue pill, you wake up in your bed, and you can believe whatever you want to believe. You go back to how it was. But he says, you take the red pill, and there is no turning back. You're now in the real world. He's given this choice. He's been shown the real world, right? And you can choose to live it, accept it, believe it, or go back to what things were before. And we're given the same kind of choice, pass through the door into another world. Not that you leave this earth, but that you recognize there is a God, and this God has a desire for how we live our lives. There is this choice given to us. I know many people are skeptical even about whether there is a God at all. So we've tried to give some reasons to believe based on history, looking at science, art, beauty. We get some glimpses also of, well, what we mean when we talk about, when I mean about another world, is that this physical world that we live in is a real, I mean, we experience it, but there are different ways of understanding what the physical world is. People who do not believe in God think this is all there is. There is nothing more. There are some other religions in the world that say that this physical world is an illusion and it will deceive you. And so the solution is to escape from the world, to be detached from it. And the way that the Bible understands the world around us is that it is a good part of God's creation, but it is not all there is. There is also God who stands apart from the creation. And we have the opportunity and the ability to connect with this God who created this world. Then we can say this world that we live in is good, even though it is also filled with evil. And we will walk through the door that leads us into the presence of God, where there is no longer any evil, and there is no longer any death. How do we get from this to that? How do we enter eternal life? Well, the same, this is a relevant question. People are asking, is it possible to change the path that I'm on? Is it possible to live a different life? Can a person who is in prison come out as a different man? Can a person who is feeling stuck find some new way of living? Sometimes people say, well, yes, of course, just change it. Just make a change. Make different decisions. Which is good as far as it goes. I had a friend who, his story is that he cut himself once when the chain came off of a chainsaw and sliced his leg open. And his mother was a nurse, and so he says he just went to her office and got some needle and thread and stitched his own leg up. Which sounds crazy to me. I would pass out, as some of you know. Now, you can stitch your own leg if you're crazy like my friend Mike, but he would never think about trying to do surgery on his own heart. There are parts of ourselves that we can change, but when it gets down deep, we find we just can't change our pride. We just can't change our greed. We just can't change our selfishness. And when we realize this, we can't just do a little stitch ourselves up. What we need to do is put ourselves on the operating table and let the surgeon do what the surgeon does. We need a new heart. We need to become a new person. So the way through is not just make a change. The door that is open to us is through the person of Jesus Christ, who came from God's presence as a human being like us and suffered and died and rose from the dead. And if we follow him, we follow the same pattern. Death and resurrection and return to the presence of God. Leaving our sinful self behind. And Jesus actually said, if you want to follow me, he said, you need to take up your cross. Be ready to give your life. He said, if a person tries to save their life, they will lose it. But if you give up your life, you end up saving it. This is the invitation. Lay yourself down to die. A part of yourself, the selfishness, to say, I want this part to be left behind. And I want to be raised from the dead. Now, we've only been here a couple of months, but I've had enough conversations with people from this church, from the area. I've realized there are some of you who come from very religious backgrounds, and you hear words like sin and judgment, and it brings back this whole feeling of guilt and fear. And that's not where I want you to end up. There's another part in this passage that I want you to see. God is wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient. Let me say this again. God is wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient. God wants us to turn to him. God is pleased when people turn to him. when we get to the baptisms at the very end of this service, we plan to look at this verse in Luke chapter 15, where Jesus is telling parables about things that are lost and that are found. A coin that's lost and is found, a sheep that is lost and is found, a son that is lost and is found. And the point in all three is that there is more rejoicing in heaven among God's angels over one person who is lost and returns home than over all the others who have no need. This is God's desire, God's great pleasure. It's for people to turn back. And so God is wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient. So after all your struggling and your doubting, you're resisting, you're wondering if you're in the right path, wondering, is God really there? Does God really care about me? After all these things, you hear God say, I love you. Welcome home. This is the God we know through Jesus. Wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient. The door is not through our own goodness, it's through the goodness of Jesus Christ. And if you wonder about God's love and acceptance of you, I would simply ask the question back, did Jesus die for you? Did Jesus die for you? Then you know I'm accepted and loved by God. Not looking at your own self, you're looking to Jesus. There was a woman who attended Harvard University, which is quite famous in the United States and probably around the world. You may have heard of Harvard. It was founded to train Christian students, but over the years it has become a very non-Christian place. This woman who attended back several years, quite a few decades ago, was not a Christian and was very skeptical. And she tells the story about how her sister, who had been through a really difficult time in her life, 3 times her apartment was robbed, and then she ended up spending time in the hospital for an ulcer, all kinds of stress, and then her sister comes home to visit at Christmas time. And this woman sees her sister, that the lines under her eyes are gone. She looks young again. She looks happy. And the sister says, what happened to you? She says, what happened to me? Well, I've become a Christian. And this sister and a friend, a roommate who'd come with her, they go into the room and they say, she's crazy. Can we talk her out of this? How could she believe this nonsense about Jesus and the Bible and all these things? Some of the same kind of pressure some of you face, right? And they try to talk her out of it, and she's able to give responses and say, this is why I believe, this is what I believe. But finally, after all the arguing and the debating, her conclusion, she says, all I know is I wouldn't want to live a single day of my life without him. Saying, I've walked through the door. I know Jesus. I know his love for me. I don't want to live a single day without him. This is the invitation given to us. To step through the door, put your life in his hands, and know God's love and God's care for you. And once you've walked through, you'll say, I would never want to live a single day without Jesus. Jesus came from the presence of God into our world, and he said, one of the things he said about himself is, I am the gate. I am the way, the truth, and the life. All these things that we're talking about here are represented in baptism. In preparing these people to be baptized, we explained that it means 3 things, actually 4 things, but I have pictures for 3. One is that it is like being washed clean. Huh? This is the first thing that comes to mind because we use water. But Nick, in the children's message, he said, is there something special about that water that washes you clean? No, it can't get inside. It can't get into your soul. But we use water because this is how we wash our bodies. But how do you wash your soul? Well, this takes Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and it's represented in baptism. It's about the forgiveness of sins. And the second thing that it means is a new birth. Jesus invited a people, he said, you need to be born again. You need to start new. God will bring something new to life in you. This is also represented in baptism. And a third thing, and the pictures here are not the greatest, but this is the best I could find, of death and resurrection. You are united with Jesus in baptism, in his death, which you see as a person goes under the water and lifted out of death, raised to new life, which is represented when a person is coming out of the water. There is a part that dies and is left behind, and there is a new person that comes to life. This is what we get in baptism. This is not happening through the water. It is happening by the Spirit of God. When a person is baptized, it is showing what God is already doing on the inside. What God is already doing on the inside. The other thing that it means to be baptized is the sign of entry into God's church, into God's covenant promises, and into his kingdom. All those things wrapped up in one symbol. This is what we have the great privilege of celebrating this morning. Seven people united with Christ, stepping through the door into the presence of God through Christ his Son. I'd like to pray together, and we'll ask these people to come forward, and they will have the opportunity, if they wish, to share a part of their story, what their life was like before, how they came to know Jesus, and how things are different now. Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you that you are wonderfully kind and tolerant and patient, wanting us to turn back to you, ready to give forgiveness, ready to shower us with your love. We pray for these who are being baptized that they have confidence that comes from the presence of your Spirit in them. And for anybody who is questioning, wondering where they stand with you, help them, Lord, turn their eyes to Jesus and to know they are forgiven, accepted, and loved. In Jesus' name, amen.